Good afternoon, everybody, and you're very welcome to this Sustainable Energy Use in Horticulture webinar. This is the second webinar in the series of Sustainable Energy webinar we've had in the Horticulture Department. My name is Owen Sweetman. I am a Teagasc Vegetable Advisor, and I'm hosting this webinar with my colleague Donal Gernan, who is the Mushroom Advisor in Teagasc. So you may have seen, if you logged into the solar webinar that we had 2 weeks ago, this day 2 weeks ago, there is a link to the recording. If you haven't seen that, it was on the invitation that you received to this webinar. You can go back and watch it. And today we are joined by Barry and a grower, John Hagen, and Marie Ryan from the planning in Tipperary County Council. So before we get into it, I will just give us a quick run through of some of the quick housekeeping. You may be familiar with some of this information already if you've been on previous webinars. You are all on mute. You can't be seen or heard. The webinar is being recorded, so you can watch it back. The recording will be made available in the next few days. There is a question and answer function at the centre at the bottom of your screen, and we would ask you to stick in your questions there for any of our speakers today. The webinar will wrap up at 5 o'clock sharp, so we will have an hour of information and questions and wrap up at that time. So before I hand you over to our first speaker, I am just going to run through a poll which we do at the start of webinars just to get your engagement. We appreciate your engagement in these polls, which gives us an indication of who the audience is and what you're thinking is. So I'm going to launch the poll now. It should be coming up on your screen. And there's just four short questions. The first one is, what is your base energy usage in kilowatt per hour? The options are 0 to 15, 15 to 50, 50 to 100, 100 to 200, 200 to 500, or greater than 500 kilowatt hours, or I don't know. So I ask you to stick in your answers there, please, and I'll keep going. Second question is, are you considering installing a wind turbine within the next 12 months? Yes, no, or not sure. Third question, within the next 3 years, are you planning to generate both wind and solar power to supply your business needs? Yes, both wind and solar. Just wind, just solar, or neither. The final question is, are you interested in any other energy related technologies? We put in a couple of options here: anaerobic digester, combined heat and power, heat pumps, geothermal, hydroelectric, electric, chilling technology, biomass, or other. So I'll give you a few moments now to put in your answers to that short poll, and I'll share you up on the screen and I'll very quickly take you through them. Okay, I think we'll go with that. Sharing the results on your screen now. So what is your base energy usage? We can see quite a few people up towards the higher end of the scale here, actually. And then a good 53% say they don't know. And again, I just point you back to the SEAI energy audit that we discussed in the previous webinar. And those people who don't know, maybe look to figure it might be tricky to have off the top of your head. But if you don't know and don't know where to find out, that's a good place to start when considering your energy usage. Are you considering installing a wind turbine within the next 12 months? 27% said yes, 53% said not sure, and the rest said no. Within the next 3 years, you're planning on to generate both wind and solar. Yes, both wind and solar, so those two complementary sources of energy. 60% of people are interested in that. Interesting actually that so many are interested in wind and solar, and only 7% interested in just wind. And then the other energy-related technologies people are interested in, anaerobic digesters, biomass, chilling technology, a little bit of everything across the board, then heat pumps. I hope we've covered some of the main ones. So I'll stop sharing there.
A large interest in biomass there, Owen.
Yeah, and just to point out that our energy, or our next, the third webinar in our series, which is 4 o'clock next Monday, is on biomass. So anybody interested in that, it would be very useful for you to log into that webinar. So thanks for your engagement in that poll there. It's useful to know where everybody's thoughts are. And I'm going to hand you over now to Mr. Barry Caslin, who is the Teagasc Energy and Rural Development Specialist. Barry gave the presentation last week on solar, or 2 weeks ago, sorry, on solar and PV, and is going to give us a presentation on wind turbines. And I'll hand it over to you now, Barry, if you're ready.
Yeah, thanks. It was well worthwhile doing that poll there, Owen, because you know, it gives a good idea of what people are thinking. And you just mentioned there the fact that, you know, that you can actually get support there from SEAI for doing energy audits. So something that people should be considering is, as a company, you're entitled to support there. I think it's in the region of €2,000 to do an energy audit on your farm. So it's an important point. Yeah, and as you mentioned, we will be doing biomass next week. So biomass is very relevant to the horticultural sector as well. And the SSRH, we'll be talking about that next week as well, and how we can support farmers and growers in this area. Yeah, I'll start sharing my screen there now, Owen, if you can tell me if you can see it okay.
Not just yet, Barry. It's probably loading up. It's coming now. Yep, that's all right. Go ahead, Barry.
Okay. All right, good afternoon, everyone. So thanks for the introduction, all. So I'm going to talk to you today about wind. Last week, the topic was PV. We're staying on the topic of electricity generation. So next week, as I say, it will be heat. But in the whole area of electricity, I suppose this is another technology which we can be using to generate electricity, and supposed to be in terms of being more energy self-sufficient and generating your own on-site. And the fact that now you can export electricity to the grid and get paid for it, there is a big interest from people about how you can do it. And of course, wind and solar are intermittent technologies. They're not generating electricity all the time. Solar is generating electricity when the sun is shining. Wind is generating electricity when the wind is blowing. So it doesn't always meet your needs. And sometimes an interaction of the two, having them both working for you, and maybe combined with battery storage, can make a lot of sense for farms, especially where you have a large base load of electrical base load requirement. And wind is something that's not new. It's been around for a long number of years. It's been used by farmers for grinding grain, for pumping water for a long number of years. But today, electric utilities are getting the most attention for using wind power. And that's why mills are being turned into wind turbines, with much bigger and more powerful machines. So, you know, you can have small little turbines that are only watts. You see them on boats and generating a small amount of electricity, maybe on smaller pieces of equipment like that. Whereas you can go up to the kilowatts and up to the megawatts of output. So the need for clean energy becomes greater. So does engineers' efforts to design and build bigger and more efficient wind turbines, with emphasis on more acceptability by the public, and making them neater, less noisy, and yet provide a renewable source of power. So these technologies have improved in terms of noise reduction, in terms of that they're less obtruse in the surrounding environment as well. The different forms of energy, the unit of energy is the joule, and the rate of producing energy is power, which is the joule per second, or the watt, called after James Watt. So watt always has a capital W. And there's five different forms of energy. So there's mechanical energy, chemical energy, electrical energy. They're the two we're talking about today. So wind energy is the kinetic energy from the wind blowing that generates the power by turning the turbine, the rotors on the turbine, and that converting that mechanical energy into electrical energy. You have chemical energy, nuclear energy, thermal energy. It's what we'll be talking about next week on the biomass webinar. So that's an example there. The higher you go, the higher the velocity of the air, and you get more kinetic energy. As it hits the turbine or the rotors, it slows down and you get lower velocity, but that power, that energy, has gone into the turbine, which is generating the power. So you can see there that there's different efficiency levels in different parts or components of the wind turbine. There's rotors that have different levels of efficiency, gearboxes, generators, and then the conversion into electrical, from mechanical into electrical energy. So there's different efficiencies there. And when you're planning a project, some people will be looking at maybe a large scale, a number of turbines within a field, which are so-called wind farm. Others might be looking for maybe one or two turbines to serve their needs on site. Others might be looking for maybe a small turbine, maybe of 6 kilowatts, maybe 20, 25 kilowatts that might meet their a certain amount of their needs on their farm or business. You're looking at the regional resource evaluation, you know, the wind resource that will be in your area. You're looking at the selection of the wind turbine itself, which technology you're going to go for that meets your needs, the site selection, because not every site is going to be suitable for wind. You know, if you're on one side of a mountain where you're going to, or a large hill where the wind is going to be blocked, you'll have lower wind speeds. And ideally, you're looking for wind speeds of over 6 meters per second. You may have permits required that you might have to apply for. And they should be sized so that the output meets the requirements. So they all have outputs, rated outputs. And you have to look at that to see, will this rated output meet your needs on site? This is a website that's used by SEAI, the Sustainable Energy Authority of Ireland, and it's a GIS wind map that you can go into various parts of the country and that you can see what are the different wind speeds at 20 meters in height that would be potentially available in that particular area. Now, it's just a rough guide, but it's probably a first port of call if you're looking to put a turbine in an area that there is this resource on the SEAI website. And just as well, of course, it's important to be aware that we talked about solar again last week. There's no movable parts with the solar. There's very little maintenance to be done with it. It just to clean it, you know, maybe once a year, or maybe twice a year, if there's any dust on the solar panels. In the case of the wind turbine, there's a lot more moving parts. You have brakes, you have yaw drives, you have motors, you have gearboxes. And all of these moving parts, they require maintenance. So, you know, you could be talking about, depending on the size of the turbine, there could be an expense that you may have to bear in mind that you might have to endure every 2 months or every year in terms of service charges, because these components will need to be greased and maybe changed at some point in time as well. So they're the different parts, the main parts of the components of a wind turbine. Two different types of turbine. One has horizontal axis and the other vertical axis turbine. So they're classified based on their axis of rotation. The positive environmental impacts of wind turbines. So in terms of air quality, they're deemed to be, you know, there's no combustion, there's no nuclear reaction. So it's pollution free, it's carbon neutral generation of power, of electricity. It's renewable and it's free. The wind is free and it's available everywhere. I've put up this slide as well, just that if you go onto the SEAI website, the Sustainable Energy Authority of Ireland website, and just Google their emission factors, you'll see that there's an emission factor for different types of fuels. So whether it's petrol, coal, LPG. So you can see there, coal will be 0.341 tons of CO2 per megawatt hour of generated energy from coal, for example. Natural gas has its own one. Electricity has one as well. The factor actually has come down for electricity in the last number of years, because more of our electricity now is being produced from wind by very big wind farms around the country. And renewables will be deemed to have zero. So I suppose from a green credentials, this is good from the maybe from the horticultural industry perspective, that you're marketing your products and you're trying to get into shops and you're trying to get shelf space. And this may be a help as well in terms of your tendering process as well, the fact that you're using carbon neutral technologies to generate your power on site. I suppose the advantages of wind power is that it's free, and with modern technology, it can be captured efficiently, and those technologies are improving all the time. Once the turbine is built, the energy it produces does not cause greenhouse gases or other pollutants. There's no combustion. Although the wind turbines can be very tall, each takes up only a small plot of land. So this means that land below can still be used. So it's possible to graze cattle or sheep around it, or have tillage crops around it as well, as you'll see right across Europe. Many people find wind farms an interesting feature of the landscape. Remote areas that are not connected to the electricity power grid can use wind turbines to produce their own supply. Wind turbines have a role to play in both the developed and the third world. Wind turbines are available in a range of sizes, so that means a vast range of people and businesses can use them. So single households, they might be using maybe a small 6 kilowatt turbine, and you know, you're going up to the larger, maybe 6 megawatt turbines, which are massive units indeed. Some of the disadvantages, and I suppose some people have heard a lot of negativity about wind over the last number of years, because they do stand out a bit more than solar. They're much higher, taller, and standing out that you do see them in the horizon or in the landscape. The strength of the wind is not constant, and it varies from zero to storm force. And this means that wind turbines do not produce the same amount of electricity all the time. I mentioned that earlier on, that they're intermittent, so you mightn't necessarily be getting the power when you need it. So there will be times when they don't produce any electricity at all. Many people feel that the countryside should be left untouched without these large structures being built. Wind turbines can be noisy, but as I say, the technology has improved, and that's what engineers are really focusing on, is reducing the noise impact from them. Many people see large wind turbines as unsightly structures, and I suppose it's based on the person themselves, if they like it or they don't like it. As I mentioned in the previous slide, some people like them. And some people feel they disfigure the countryside and are generally ugly. When wind turbines are being manufactured, some pollution is produced. Therefore, wind power does produce some pollution, and that goes with producing anything, whether it's an electric car as well. Large wind farms are needed to provide entire communities with enough electricity. So the turbine output, so the wind turbine obtains its power by converting the force of the wind into a torque or a turning force, so acting on the rotor blades. So the amount of energy which the wind transfers to the rotor, that's going to depend on the wind speed. So I mentioned ideally you're looking for a wind speed of 6 meters per second. It is possible some people put up what's called anemometers to measure the wind speed and to see what exactly is it, because I showed you the GIS map earlier on, but you know, you could potentially put up an anemometer and measure the wind speed and get a more accurate reflection of what you are generating in your area. And some people put those up for maybe 12 months before they put up wind turbines. The density of the air, that's a constant. And then the rotor area. And there's a formula for working that out. So the power of the wind is calculated by the watts, is the 0.5 times the area meter squared by the air density in kilograms per cubic meter, that's 1.23. Multiply by the wind speed, if that's 6 meters per second or 5 meters per second, whatever it may be. Yeah, I suppose I just put this up. I had it up last week as well, and it just looks at, you know, that there is a lot of energy. You know, the first ones are used for heat, and we'll be focusing on that next week, of what a mushroom unit would generally use energy-wise. But you can see a lot of electricity is used typically, you know, for the cooling of growing rooms on mushroom units, 845 kilowatt hours per ton of mushrooms. So that's quite a high figure there. So a lot of energy being used on mushroom units, and more for maybe packing, lighting, crop chilling, ventilation. So, you know, you will have some people who are more efficient than that, and you will have best practice examples there as well that will have lowered those figures. Generally on glass houses, we look at it in per square meter, kilowatt hours per square meter. It's a different metric. But, you know, this doesn't reflect all glass houses, but it just gives you an idea that where the electricity is being used in refrigeration, lighting, heating, ancillaries, pumps, fans in that area. And then, of course, there is a potential use for biomass for heating there as well, but electricity is certainly in use there as well. So what's the supports for all this? Many of you have heard about the microgeneration support scheme. So if you put up a turbine less than 50 kilowatts at the moment, you can get paid for any excess electricity that you're exporting back to the grid. In what's called the Clean Export Premium, or the CEP. And that's being paid at 13.5 cents per kilowatt hour. It's actually not available at the moment. It's still not available at the moment, but what you can get is the CEG, the Clean Export Guarantee. And that's available for any excess electricity under microgeneration from these renewable technologies. So the CEG is paid by your utility. So if you're getting your electricity from SE or Tricity or Electric Ireland or Pinergy or Borgosh, wherever you're getting your electricity from, they would pay you the Clean Export Guarantee or the market rate. They've all come out with prices in recent weeks and months at this stage, and saying what they will offer you for any excess electricity that you can generate through microgeneration. There is an application process that you'd have to go through to sell the excess electricity back to the grid. The technology provider would help you with that. So if it's solar or if it's a wind turbine, they'd help you in that whole application process of exporting back to the grid. But it is possible to do it today. It wasn't possible last year. So you can get paid now for any excess electricity going back to the grid. And the market rates are actually quite good. That those CEG rates, they're better than the CEP rates. The CEG rates are anywhere between 18 to 22 cents per kilowatt hour. Whereas if we'd been talking about this time last year, you would have been lucky to get 5 cents per kilowatt hour for any excess electricity. So certainly for microgeneration rates. So that's to support the smaller turbines at microgeneration and encourage people to produce small amounts of electricity and export it back here and there. So their turbine could be turbines 6 kilowatts to 50 kilowatts, or again, solar PV in that range as well. But there is also a pilot scheme there for a small scale generation pilot scheme that's there at the moment for technologies up to 200 kilowatts that you can also get paid for excess electricity back to the grid. But there's above that, there's no payment system at the moment between 200 kilowatts and 500 kilowatts. Above 500 kilowatts, you're generally supported through what's called the RES scheme, the Renewable Electricity Support Scheme. So that supports larger generation sites. That's where you see large fields covered in, 100 acre sites covered in solar PV or with wind turbines. They're all being supported through the RES scheme, the Renewable Electricity Support Scheme. So that's the government's support mechanism to help us meet our renewable electricity targets that we have for 2030 and beyond. Just an example of a payback. So it's just one particular one that I price. I won't go naming any companies or anything like that, but it was a company, I asked them for a price of an 80 kilowatt turbine, and they said all in, it would cost around 140,000 for an 80 kilowatt turbine. The foundations for that particular job would be maybe 25,000 euro. The delivery and the installation and the commission of it will be around 25,000. And now grid connection is one of these unknowns. It could be 10,000, it could be 40,000. It all depends on, the lines that we brought to it and the lines that are in the area and the transformer capacity in the area and the ability to export back to the grid. So potentially, you could be talking about 30,000, it could be higher. So if we assume the total costs are 220,000, an 80 kilowatt turbine, generally the way I would work it is it's 80 multiplied by the hours in the year. So there's 8,760 hours in the year. So you must, and then you work by an efficiency factor of maybe 25%. So that'd be the kilowatt hours of electricity that it would generate in the year. So that's so if you, in this particular example, if you say that you are currently paying 40 cents for your electricity and you're producing 150,000 kilowatt hours, but you're using 100,000 kilowatt hours of that, that's 100,000 by the 40 cents, that's 40,000 euro of a saving that turbine is giving you in your first year. And if you're exporting 50,000 kilowatt hours, I've just rounded the figure again to 20 cents per kilowatt hour, that's an income of 10,000 euro. So you add your 40,000 and your 10,000, that's an annual saving there of 50,000 euro per year. So that would give you a simple payback, not allowing for bank interest rates or borrowings or anything like that, of 4.4 years of a payback in that particular example. So it is possible to work out if it's an 80 kilowatt or 100 kilowatt turbine or a 6 kilowatt. If it's 6 kilowatts, you're multiplying it by the 8,760 hours in the year, and you multiply that by a performance factor or an efficiency of around maybe 20 to 25%, depending on the wind speeds that are going to be in your area or predicted to be in your area. That's just an example of a wind turbine, a small scale 8 kilowatt turbine in Lambay Island that they're using as a replacement for a diesel generator. It's off grid. They require planning permission for that particular one. I know Marie is going to be talking about planning permission after a while, but I think if you're over 20 meters up to the tip of the rotor blade, or if you're under that, you're exempt from planning, but there may be other conditions. And this particular project, the time to complete it was one day, not including the running of the cables. The capital cost of that particular one was 25,000 euro. This was, I think this is about 5 years ago when this was installed. The kilowatt hours saved annually is 17,000 for this particular one. And it's been done in conjunction with, it's off-grid, as I mentioned, in conjunction with solar PV and battery storage. So So they're able to use the PV, which is generating electricity during the day. Wind is generating electricity during the day and potentially at night as well. And the battery being topped up, so that's providing supply of electricity on the island there of Land Bay. And just that you're aware of, I'm sure most of you are aware of the Department of Agriculture, Food and Marine, that they have the capital investment grant support. That supplies grant aid of 40% support. I presume wind turbines will occur, and Donal might comment on that after a while, but 40% support for capital investments, including sustainability options, including energy. And there's a 50% support for those under 35 years of age. And there's also a possible PO support there of 50% or producer organizations of 50%, and it could be potentially higher, I'm told, in certain situations if they're meeting certain efficiency standards. So there, the support there for all the necessary equipment, including inverters, labor, etc. I just wanted to mention battery storage as well. You know, in battery storage, there's lots of different brands out there. Batteries can operate in both alternating current or direct current. In our homes and in our businesses, we use it as alternating current. And this is where we need the inverters to convert it from direct current into alternating current. So batteries can be charged in direct current by surplus solar or wind at the daytime. And once discharged, can be recharged on cheaper night rate electricity for discharge in the morning. So this is where batteries can be useful. That picture in the top right-hand corner there is two 13 kilowatt hour batteries. So you can stack them up on top of each other, so you can have multiples of that. So that's just to give you an idea what batteries look like. So it allows surplus energy generated by the wind turbines to be stored for later use. It maximizes your self-generated electricity. It's proactive role in future energy systems and reducing carbon emissions. You can work off-grid or as energy self-sufficient as possible. You need to assess your annual farm or your household electricity usage and generation capacity of your wind turbine. And next, you need to consider the likely installation costs based on the type of battery that you want. So there's two main types of batteries. You have your lithium ion, which is like your mobile phone or your iPads and those type of devices. They have a high energy density or kilowatt hour per kilogram. They're more expensive though than the other batteries, which is your lead acid or typically would have been your car batteries. So the lead acid, they tend to be used off grid where a lot more electricity storage is required. The capacity of the battery too is important. There's a lot of people assume that if it's a 14 kilowatt hour or 15 kilowatt hour battery that you'll get full use of that. That's not necessarily the case, because they shouldn't be discharged fully. So a 14 kilowatt hour battery might have a usable capacity of 13.5 kilowatt hours. So you, that's something that you'd have to be discussing with your battery supplier as well, about appropriately sizing the battery storage to meet your self-sufficiency requirements. Another question you'd be asked in relation to batteries is the number of charge cycles it can take, because batteries, you know, they go for full cycles or full discharge, but that's very, very rare. If you think of your mobile phone, you might charge it when it's 40% or 30%, it mightn't be discharged fully. So that's a partial charge. So this is when you're looking at a new battery or buying a new battery, you're looking at the number of charge cycles that is warranted for, and most of them are for 6,000 to 10,000 cycles. So this is different to a product warranty or this is a performance warranty that will be expected from the batteries over its lifetime. So if you take an example there, if you had a warranty for 10,000 charge cycles, a 12 kilowatt hour battery should give you 100 or should store 120,000 kilowatt hours of energy during its lifetime. So the charge and the discharge rate, this is the power input and output in kilowatts. So you have to ensure that you have enough power or output to run the appliance. And an example of that is a 5 kilowatt hour output could run a kettle, tumble dryer or electric fire, but a 2 kilowatt output probably can't. It wouldn't have the power in it to do that. So if you can't access enough stored power when you need it, you get this thing called the bottleneck effect, and this is where grid electricity is going to be required to supplement the difference. So if you can generate 4 kilowatts and your battery can only take 2.5 kilowatt hours, you're wasting 1.5 kilowatts of power in that process. So in terms of AC or DC coupling, a wind turbine inverter, wind turbine needs an inverter, as does a battery. So AC is the most common way of sending electricity around the grid. So this, the inverter converts it from direct current into alternating current. So a system using DC coupling has a single combined inverter. A system with AC coupling requires separate inverters for batteries and panels, but you need to speak to an installer about getting those types of systems installed. So Owen, I'll finish up with this slide here. Just there's opportunities for development on farms is great. There's lots of space on farms. Sometimes maybe horticultural units or mushroom units might be tighter on space, but that's where a wind turbine could maybe work quite well. Wind causes no emissions to the air, to the soil or the water. Wind can meet on-site electricity needs for heating, pumping, ventilation and process energy. Electricity prices have continuously fluctuated in recent months, and increases in electricity prices in coming years is likely. Don't forget 50% or almost 50% of our electricity is coming from gas. That's a very volatile resource at the moment, and that's what's leading to the fluctuations at the moment in electricity prices especially. Ireland will see an increased shift towards farm use of renewable energy, and battery storage is a rapidly evolving technology. So I'll leave it at that, Owen, for the moment, if you, whatever way you want to do it.
Thanks very much, Barry. And plenty of questions there. I think we're going to deal with questions at the end, but I'll just pass you over to Donal now, who's going to introduce our next speaker.
Yeah. Thanks for that, Barry. That was an excellent overview of wind turbines. And just to address before we go any further in relation to grant aid, you also mentioned there. So yes, there is a potential, there's 50% grant aid to the producer organizations for technologies such as wind turbines. There would be possibly higher grant aid if certain environmental targets are met for a producer organization, or if it's a new producer organization that has been set up. So there is possibilities for higher grant aid for such technologies. So I'll hand you over to Marie Ryan, who's working as the senior executive planner in Tipperary County Council. So she is the head of development, management and enforcement. Marie has over 25 years working in the private and public sector, dealing with various projects and developments. Marie also has a master's in environmental engineering and in spatial planning. Recently, Marie joined the Southeast Technical University as an associate lecturer on their courses in lifelong learning. So Marie will address any questions around planning with smaller and larger scale wind turbines.
Great, thanks, Donald. Can you just let me know you can see my screen there? Thanks everybody for attending this evening, and thanks for the invite from Teagasc. Just to present a quick overview for you for the planning side of things, what exemptions you have and what types of development might actually need planning permission. So if we start here with Planning and Development Act as amended, that was done in 2000. So it's a fairly hefty and extensive act that we have. And under that, the minister can make regulations for exemptions for certain types of development. And then they were made in 2001 and amended over the years. So for wind turbines and for any other type of development, there is a stipulation that any development that requires an environmental impact assessment or an appropriate assessment is not exempted development, and therefore your exemptions don't apply. In addition to that overriding limitation, there are restrictions under Article 9 of the regulations, and some of those could affect your potential exemptions that you might have for your wind turbine. So, for example, the likes of a contradiction of a condition that was attached to a permission for your landholding or for your farm or some of your buildings and things like that. If it endangers public safety by reason of a traffic hazard or an obstruction for road users, so depending on where your wind turbine is, and if it's deemed maybe that visually it might attract the attention of a driver, it might be a traffic hazard. If it interferes with the character of a landscape or a view or a special amenity area that's an objective of the development plan for that county, that would also limit the exemption that you have. Another one would be if it were to interfere with or alter or cause the demolition of a record of monuments or places, that also would delimit you. another one that might come into effect in an area that you might have your land holding. And I don't know if you've all heard of the Natura 2000 sites, which are special areas of conservation and are special protection areas. So if you're sitting in one of those, and again, that's where the appropriate assessment might kick in and you would lose your exemption, your automatic exemption on that. The other ones are our natural heritage areas that you might have heard of. And again, if it's in an impact on those designated areas, you could potentially lose your exemption. And then an unusual one is if it will consist or comprise of the extension, alteration, repair or renewal of an unauthorized structure or a structure for which the use is an unauthorized use. So if you had a land holding and you had some buildings on it, and part of the use of those, your wind turbine producing the electricity for those, that they in their day might have needed planning permission, you would lose your exemption for your wind turbine in that respect. So if you don't have an exemption, you will need to apply for planning permission. And just a couple of items there on what a planning permission would entail. So in general, and most of you would have been aware of it, the application form, the site notice, the newspaper notice, your plans and drawings. So where is the land holding? What are you proposing to put up? Barry's drawings there of the details of the wind turbine, its height, its design, what the blade lengths would be and things like that. And then you might need specialist assessments and reports. So that's including there a few of those. They're not limited to these ones. You might have a visual impact or a noise impact. Again, your heritage impact with your SACs and SPAs, your Natura impact. You might have a traffic assessment. Basically, you have to get the turbine to the site, and then your road survey might kick in with that as well. Can you actually physically get it to the site? And if you can't, what you might have to do to the roads to make it viable to get your proposed development on site. So moving on to the good news side of it, I suppose, the exemptions. And if you do qualify for an exemption, based on the limitations that have already been mentioned, there are still further conditions and limitations under each. So Schedule 2, Part 1 of the Planning and Development Regulations lists two categories in where might be of interest to yourselves, Class 2 and Class 56. Class 2 is with regard to the curtilage of a house, if you wanted to put a wind turbine up, and Class 56 if you're an industrial building, a light industrial building or business premises, and that might be the one that would kick in for some people with regard to where they're proposing to put the wind turbine. In under both of these classes, there is limitations and conditions that have to be met. And Barry alluded to a few of those there earlier. So basically, for the one within a house, you can have one wind turbine. You can't have two. The height of the wind turbine can't exceed 13 metres and the rotary diameter of 6 metres. Whereas with regard to an industrial building, a business premises, your total height of your wind turbine could be 20 metres. So it's slightly higher, slightly bigger, and the rotary diameter 8 metres. And that being the case, again, obviously your business premises or industrial building is slightly bigger than your house. So for visual impact and for the ability to be able to put it on a site, it can take a bigger wind turbine. And there's other items there as well with regard to the decibel. So the noise levels that can be accommodated at your site or at your site boundary, depending on which one you're putting it on. Again, just to be aware for the agricultural one, Schedule 2, Part 3. This one brings in a different class, so Class 18, and that's for the agricultural landholding. And again, in that one, there's different conditions and limitations. So for example, for the house, you had 13 metres of wind turbine height. For your agricultural landholding, it is back to the 20 metres as well. You have other items that you have to meet with regard to your distance from non-electrical overhead cables, from a 38 kV cable line, that's 20 metres of a distance, 30 metres from the centre line of any electrical transmission line of 110 kV. The wind turbine is 100 metres from any existing wind turbines. So if your neighbour has a wind turbine, you have to keep 100 metres from that when it's on your agricultural landholding, 5 kilometres from the nearest airport and aerodrome. And again, that's an important one because you may be fairly close to an aerodrome. You actually have to measure the distance to it. If you're under the 5 kilometres, you don't meet your exemption rights. I mentioned the noise levels, and again, 43 dBA is the normal operation that's measured from the nearest habitable house for your agricultural land holdings, and it's from your site boundaries when it's a wind turbine on your own site in your own house. And again, for the agricultural land holding, only one wind turbine is allowed. There's some conditions on how it's finished with regard to the matte non-reflective finish of it. And the blade to be made of material that doesn't deflect from the telecommunication signals. And this ties in especially with the aerodrome or the airport being close by as well and interfering with their telecommunications. And again, no signs or advertising to be advertised on it. If you're putting a sign on your wind turbine, then it can actually delimit you from your exemption that's available to you. So all those need to be taken into account. What I would advise is to contact your local authority. You can do a pre-planning consultation. It's filling out a form and getting some advice, and there's no cost associated with that. To get a definitive answer from your local authority, there is what's called a Section 5 declaration, and that will tell you if something is development, and if it is development, whether or not it is exempted development. And that's a formal piece of paper that you will have if you get it, or when you get it, that if a neighbour has a complaint, you've already checked it out. You already know that what you're doing is exempted development, and that's of great benefit. The unfortunate thing about that is there is a slight fee for that, and it is 80 euro. That's regardless of what local authority you're applying to. But again, in the long run, it can be a valuable piece of paper that you will have that won't draw the local authority and the planning section and the enforcement section on you if a neighbour or somebody like that might have a complaint for you. So great if you have your exemptions. There is one other item to be aware of, and I mentioned there a few minutes ago, is the need for an EIA or an AA. There is two parts to the regulations, part one and part two of Schedule 5, that gives the EIA projects that need EIAs. And under part two, there is a threshold for wind power. And what it reads is the installation for the harnessing of wind power for energy production, so that's the wind farms, with more than five turbines or having a total output greater than 5 megawatts. So if you meet either of those thresholds, if you're above either of those thresholds, there is an automatic requirement for an EIA, which also means you don't have your exemptions. If you're below those thresholds, so if you're proposing to put in, for example, 3 wind turbines, then it is advised to contact the local authority and carry out a screening on the need for an EIA. And in doing that and engaging with the local authority, you will get the advice on whether they consider that you may need to go in for planning permission, even though you are below the 5 wind turbines or the 5 megawatts. There is a Schedule 7 and Schedule 7A that gives you the information that you would need to have contained when you're screening for a sub-threshold development. And in that respect, carrying that out with the local authority is benefit to you, because they will look at all the layers that are involved, where your natural sites are, where your houses are, your access on your roads, and any other items that might delimit you from your exemptions. So that's a very quick run through on what we need to do, what we need to carry out with regard to planning permissions and engaging with your local authority. So I'll hand it back over to you again, and I'll stop my screen sharing.
Thanks, Marie, for that run through. Very, very useful. And I'm sure there'll be individuals with their questions, specific questions. So just to remind people again, just to stick their questions into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. But we'll keep going for the moment. And I would just like to bring on our next speaker now, who is John Hagan. And if John can stick on his camera and mic, please. There's John. So John is the Group Purchasing Manager with Country Crest and has been for the past 8 years. He has a background in agriculture and Bachelor in Business Studies honours degree from GMIT with a focus on agribusiness. He's a part-time growing on his own family farm and has 10 years experience in the agri-merchant industry. His work in Country Crest consists of procurement of many inputs, including packaging, energy, and farm inputs, to name just a few. He's also involved in project management, and crucially for tonight, he manages the on-site 800 kilowatt turbine and the relationship between Enercon and Country Crest on an ongoing basis. So John's going to just give us some experience of the turbine in Country Crest and what, why and how it's going for them. So John, when you're ready.
And thanks for the introduction and also for the invitation to speak here this evening. Yeah, so anybody who has maybe travelled the M1 North from Dublin Airport may have seen our turbine on the right-hand side there. Country Crest have an Enercon turbine on site, an E48 Enercon turbine, and it's been in situ since 2009. I think from our business here, we would say it's probably one of the better decisions we've ever made. It's a project that we have been, I suppose, very close to in a way here in Country Crest. We have a very sustainable ethos, I suppose, from our farming business right the way through. And it's something that always, it sat well with the business where we could produce our own electricity on site. Just going back to some of the reasons Barry mentioned out there, why you might be looking at a turbine on your site. And one very crucial one that would fit at our site here is that we've quite an upland site here. There's not many uplands in Dublin, but we are, for our turbine, we're on a great elevated site. And if you stand at the base of the turbine and look southwest, you're looking straight down across the Wicklow Mountains, across into Dublin, and all the way across to the east, and you'll see the pool bag chimney. So we have a very interrupted wind flow, I suppose, from our site in the direction of the prevailing wind straight down to the southwest. So yes, look, there's lots of reasons why, you know, we focus, I suppose, on wind or on different sustainable aspects. One thing I suppose we have here now in Country Crest is that we have 13 years of data relating to this turbine. And obviously, you know, once you know your data and your what your turbine is creating, I suppose, it makes it a lot easier. So on the average, we have seen over the years, our turbine will create about 2 gigawatts of power, so 2,000 megawatts on year on year. And just to give some highlights there, 2021 was a particularly quiet year. We were less than that. We were about 1.86 gigawatts, where 2020 was a very good year for wind production. We were up to 2.43 gigawatts. So I suppose another question that, or another topic that was mentioned here, was obviously the wind doesn't blow all the time. So why would you go with a turbine, or why would you go with something else? Back, I suppose, in 2009, now things have changed in the last 12 months, particularly with energy and the cost of energy. But back in 2009, when we were looking at the return on investment, I suppose, in this project, it was all about displacing the incoming power onto the site. So as you all know, if you look at your energy bills, you have a cost per unit, but you'll also then have a duos and a tuos charge, which is your transmission and your distribution charges. So for us, the way to value, I suppose, the energy or the value of your kilowatt coming into your incomer was to include the total charge. So you have your kilowatt hour charge plus your duos plus your tuos. So when you go to work at an ROI in it, then as long as you're displacing your incoming power, it's the best way to command an ROI in it. Barry also mentioned that the market has changed significantly in the last 12 months, I suppose, where there is an export or a reasonable price for export now. But I'd still be very cautious there, because the value of 13 cents, you know, they're given for microgeneration is, what it's reasonable, it may not be viable for an investment to invest in a capacity where you want to export to the grid. There's lots of different assumptions to be made around that as well. Can the grid in your local, can the network in your local area support your export onto it? So you'll have to just work out, is that possible? On the larger scale, and what applies to us here in Country Crest, is the market for energy now is an ISEM. It's an integrated single energy market. And particularly when we're talking about wind power, is the value of the energy retrievable, I suppose, for export depends on the actual volume of wind energy on the market at any one time. So the problem being is when we are in a situation to export, the market generally has a lot of wind power because there's a lot of wind blowing. So that would decrease the value of your kilowatt for export at that particular time. If you could export when the country is quiet wind-wise, you'll get a better value. But obviously we don't have the export at that stage. Just a few details around our own site here in Country Crest. At full production, we are running at around a base load around 900 kilowatts, maybe somewhere between 850, 950 kilowatts. So we have quite a base load that we can absorb in. So on a windy day where our turbine is working at max, we're looking at, you know, it can basically support the site on its own. Over the years, I suppose as our site has grown and developed, we're using more power. So we would say on annual now that our turbine would support about 40 to 45% of our total annual electrical needs. But we've had a great relationship. It's an Enercon machine, an E48. So we work very closely with Enercon. We have a service agreement built in with them. So they will come out and they'll service any of the maintenance issues. That'll be all on a cycle. If there is a breakdown for some reason or a stop, they usually are on site within about 2 hours. There are local branches in Wexford, so they can usually dispatch a crew within 2 hours. They have connectivity to the turbine themselves, so it's very often that they will know the turbine is stopped before I even know myself. So, the relationship there with Enercon has been very good over the years. The lifespan of the turbine, they tell us it's a 25-year working life, but there's no reason why it shouldn't progress well above that. It's been working great today. As I said, it's one of the better investments here on the site. I suppose as people are now more focused on sustainable energy, and in the last couple of years, it's a great image to have as you drive into your site, because you don't have to explain to people anymore about what a turbine does. You know, it's very visual. And people know that, you know, you're doing your bit for the environment. You're creating an on-site sustainable energy. And as I said, if you're lucky enough, like we are, to have an elevated site, I know Barry did mention a wind speed there of 6 meters per second, but we're lucky enough, we have an average wind speed of 6.8 meters per second. So it would be a very favorable site for wind production. Yeah.
Okay, thanks very much, John. That's brilliant to hear from a grower and someone that's in it now at the moment. So we might, I know Donal has a couple of questions there lined up that have come in for you. So I'll just pass it over to Donal.
Yeah, John, even personally, just listen to your talk there. You said there is, you know, there's times of the year when you don't have wind energy. I just want to investigate, have you looked at solar PV and battery storage maybe?
Yes, of course we have, yeah. And again, we have quite a considerable roof space here in Country Crest. It's probably something that we've ongoing at the moment. It makes a lot of sense to work to solar PV with your turbine. Invariably, even if you just take winter versus summer, you have more wind in the summertime. More wind in the wintertime, less in the summer, and vice versa with your solar. So for us, it's all about, I suppose, not to be too worried about the export part of it. It's all about displacing your incoming power, as I said. Mm-hmm. Once you can displace your incoming power, you can then, you know, your ROI or your return on investment, you can base it on that increased cost where you are paying your GWAS and your TWAS charges. From a battery storage, that would be the real, I suppose, jewel in the crown, where you would have a battery, you know, possibly a wind and a solar piece feeding into a battery. And when neither one or the other, as in your solar or your PV is, your solar or your wind is providing, that you could pull from your battery. So look, it's certainly, I won't say we haven't looked at it. We have. I would say that the PV piece has changed considerably in the last 5 years. The value of it has come down. The cost has come down. I think the same with batteries, and we certainly would be very open to doing something now in the next number of years in relation to that. Yeah.
Great. Okay. Just when you did mention the exporting back to the grid, how was the application process for doing that? Was it difficult, or was there any snags that you didn't expect?
It's quite difficult now, and I have to say that was pre my time here. I'm with the business 8 years here now, so this happened back in 2009. Yeah, from what I hear, it was quite difficult. And I know from we would have been exporting power onto the grid for a number of years before we actually got paid for any of it. So you know, they're quite welcome to take the power as you export it, but it did take a while to get set up on an export system that paid for its power. But again, it's been difficult. I suppose the last 12 months has been a challenge, as we all know. But pre that, and Barry rightly mentioned it out, like you're talking the small cents, you know, single digit cents figures for kilowatt export, 3-4 cents. It doesn't make sense. You're not going to base, particularly if you have to borrow money to put up a system like this, you're not going to base your ROI on export of that. I know some of the microsystems now have up to 13 cents, but still it's quite small really in the scale of things when you need to try and to retrieve an income, I suppose, to pay back this funding. Like, but at the same time, it's great if you can manage it, because once you do get your funding paid back, with the lifespan of over 20 years, 25 years, once you have your funding paid back, it's great to see it there. You know, every time it goes around, it's making you money, it's making energy.
Donald, can I just come in there? I see there was a question that came in there from Brian O'Reilly, and it was in relation to the planning costs or the yearly maintenance costs. Mm-hmm. You can come in there, John, what your yearly maintenance cost is, but generally for the smaller turbines, you could be talking about maybe €2,000 per year. And I think it's an important point. Many people put in these turbines a number of years ago at smaller scale, maybe small 6 kilowatts up to 20, 30 kilowatts, but they didn't have, you know, a service agreement with them. They weren't getting them serviced or maintained. Some of them bought them from companies out in Canada, the United States, and the parts went on them, gear boxes went on them, rotors went on them, and trying to get an after-sale service is very, very important. So I think if you are looking for a turbine, it's very, very important to look at the service and maintenance contract associated with it as well. Can you get spare parts for it if anything goes wrong? Where was it manufactured? Was it the closer to home that it was manufactured, the better? Maybe, John, you want to comment on the service or maintenance associated with your, because you have a much bigger turbine at 800 kilowatts.
Yeah, so that's obviously very important. It's not something that you're going to go at yourself. You know, if it stops, you know, you're not going to go at it yourself and try and fix it. It's a very technically detailed piece of equipment. So yeah, as I said, we chose to go with Enercon, a very established business in wind generation. And obviously it's horses for courses. You know, you may be talking about €2,000 for a system of maybe 20, 30, 40 kilowatts. Ours would be significantly higher than that now, but obviously it's per per size of the turbine. But it's a hugely important piece. There's no point in skimping. If you're going to invest that kind of money in a piece of equipment like this, there's no point in making, you know, it's like a car. Like, you're always going to get your car serviced, or you're going to make sure it's working to its optimum. There's no point in having it downtime and missing generation. But yeah, it's highly important to, I think you're right, Barry, you know, choose if you can is a very reputable company. Do your homework, and certainly, you know, you need to be signing up to some sort of an annual, at least an annual check. But as I said, there's no point in your turbine being stopped and you've nowhere to go.
I see another important point that was made there by Donald Flanagan, my colleague. You mentioned about the accelerated capital allowances that are available for wind turbines. So that's an important point as well. We mentioned it last week in relation to solar as well, that you can write it off against tax in the 1 year as opposed to writing it off as a capital cost over 8 years. So it's if somebody facing a big tax bill at the end of the year, it might be a way of reducing your tax bill as well.
Yeah, great. We're running a wee bit tight in time here, so we just might wrap up with one or two more questions. So we've got a question here. Could you estimate the cost per kilowatt of battery storage for large-scale batteries, say 500 kilowatt or higher? I think, Barry, maybe you might to be able to answer that or give it a go.
I know the cost per kilowatt has come down. It was a lot higher. I think that the cost I suppose I don't really like to say it on a webinar that's been recorded because these prices are varying over time, but I think the last figure I heard was around maybe 1,200 euro per kilowatt hour, something in that ballpark.
Okay, thank you. Another question here. So we already touched on the maintenance costs, but in relation to insurance costs of an 80 kilowatt wind turbine, Barry, do you have any estimate what you'd be looking at there for insurance cost?
I don't know, but it's a good question because it's you know, if you had a storm or if you had an outage and you were down for a few months, so it could be quite costly. I don't know, maybe John, have you any idea on that?
I'm afraid I wouldn't just have that off the top of my head either, though.
Okay, another question here. What is the plan and situation? Sorry, just after going off my screen. So what's the plan and situation on the new bladeless turbines that are available? So Marie, Marie, you might answer that.
John, I'd say the reason it went off your screen there is I was just typing it and answering it.
Okay.
The current exemptions that we have, and I suppose hopefully people are aware of the ones for the solar that have been updated recently. We were hoping that wind turbines and other technologies would come into that. But at the minute, the exemptions don't allow for any turbine to be placed on a building or any structure. So my understanding is that those ones would go on buildings. And if they do, they're not actually exempted under the current exemptions. At the end of the year, we have been promised a new Planning and Development Act. And obviously associated regulations will follow on from that. So we're hoping that an awful lot of those, they're around since 2001 and they haven't been amended. So it's time that legislation catches up with technology. So we'd be hoping the end of the year, early next year, that things will advance and those exemptions will expand to allow for technologies that have improved.
Great. Thanks for that, Marie. We'll just wrap up with one more question here. So do you know of any sites with wind, solar and battery in Ireland? So replacing 80 to 90% grid needs. Barry, again, you might be...
Yeah, I suppose that example that I gave there, Porrick, earlier on, as Porrick did ask the question, and Lambay Island, that's a good example of where they're actually using their own, they're using solar, battery and wind to generate their own electricity on the island.
Great.
And there's lots of examples in other islands like Orkney Islands where they're doing this. Is there'll be lots of other examples, and I think on Aran Islands as well they're using a lot of wind and solar as well to generate their electricity.
Okay, that's great. So we'll wrap the webinar up there. So just to let everyone know, if you did miss any of the webinar, it has been recorded. So it'll be available on the Teagasc website in the next few days. I'd also like to, if you have any more questions that you want to put to Barry, maybe first of all, go to the Teagasc website because Barry has a lot of information in relation to wind turbines on his website. And you might be able to answer it there. So just before I leave, I want to thank Barry, Marie, John and Owen for coming on to the webinar today to give some excellent insights into wind energy. And just to let you all know, the next webinar is on next Monday, the 14th, at the same time, 4 o'clock. So we look forward to seeing you there. And take care, everybody.
Thanks,
all the best.
Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, Sam. Thank
Bye-bye.
You.
Bye, all.